Hello guys, welcome back to another tutorial. Hit the bell icon button so that you don't miss out any tutorial.
Welcome back guys. In this section, we're going to look at how an artificial neural network learns. To do that, I'm going to introduce three very interesting topics. The first one is the structure of an ANN. The second one is the cost function that is at the core of the learning. And the third and last one is going to be the learning, how the learning is taking place, where it's taking place in the network. But first, let's start with a very, very simple, essential architecture structure for a neural network. How does it look like? Well, in this toy example, I used three layers. Each one has a different number of neurons. Each neuron is actually indicated with a circle. What we need to do, first of all, is to wire our network and to introduce weights that here are exemplified with these segments. Think about them really as wires that propagate signals from this neuron to all the other neurons in the following layer. Obviously, to have a network that is fully operating, we need to connect all the neurons. In this case, these two layers should be fully connected, but really depending on the architecture that you choose, this structure might change. And we will see in the other episode when we're talking about RNNs, how these connections can really vary quite dramatically. The interesting thing here is that for the network, for a good functioning of the network, we need to propagate signals in the right direction, which is the forward direction. So in other words, we need to make sure that by applying a stimulus at the first layer or input layer, we get the desired output. How to do that? Well, first of all, for propagation to take place, we need activation function. So let's look at this slide where essentially I use the following notation. I use white, as you can see here in this neuron on the at the bottom, as a proxy for indicating full activation. So this neuron is very active. A black is a neuron that is absolutely non-active, meaning that all the connections, all the signals that are coming here are stopped, are not propagating. And then there are other shades of gray that essentially encode values between non-activation and full activation. The first thing that we have to do when we are training a network is to initialize it with random values. This is precisely what I'm doing here at the moment. So I am initializing the hidden layer and the output layer with random values that I can draw from several distributions. Typically, we use Gaussian distributions to randomly sample values for these activation functions and for the weights. For the weights, I will use another color coding. I will use green here to indicate weights taking positive values, and I will use red for values that are negatives. The grays are values very close to zero that essentially mean very poor activation. Okay, now let's recall what is the scope of a neural network. Well, given a stimulus like this one, this is we're talking about here an MNIST image containing number 5, handwritten by someone, where each pixel is again between 0 and 255. So this is a matrix of integers. This matrix has the following dimensionality, 28 by 28. So we present this image to the network, and we want to have a very specific output. We want to have a 5 as an output. So let's see how we can achieve that. Well, as you can imagine, since this is a matrix of values, we can unfold this matrix into a row vector that will be applied to the input of the ANN. In practical terms, each neuron will be initialized with one pixel value. Then, with a feed-forward propagation, we will propagate these signals through the network with the activation, with the pre-loaded activation functions, and we will get an output. The output will look like this. So we will have 10 different digits to classify, and we will have probabilities for each one of them. For instance, number 8 is 0.11, so very low probability. 10, absolutely low, so 0.03. But 6 has 0.98, so very high likelihood that this is a 6. Well, it's a 5, so we're not very close to that. What the network makes here is a mistake, and we can actually see that the output that is desired is here on the right. So we would like to have a situation where all the neurons in the output layer are zero, aside from this one, number 5. If we are in this situation, the network performs optimally and gives us the exact result. Now, in practice, how do we achieve this? Well, we have a 6, not very far away from a 5, and actually a 6 kind of looks like a 5. There is a missing edge here. So how can we proceed and achieve better results? Well, the first thing that we could do is to say, okay, fair enough, we gave as input to the network this image. We collected 6. It's a mistake. And it's a mistake because probably the network was fooled by this part here on the top of the number. But we can repeat with multiple iterations and with multiple samples, like the ones that you can see here, all this procedure. So we show to the network a sample, we collect the result, and more importantly, we give a penalty when the network is making a mistake. So in a sense, what we're doing is we are trying to mimic human learning, and we're trying to teach the network how to behave. Why am I saying this? Because humans really learn in a similar manner. It's trial and error, right? You start on one point of the maze, then you get stuck, you go in the wrong way, and finally you try again, and you find the exit door. Excellent. But how to do it in practice? So how we can mimic these results in practical terms into our network? Well, the first thing that we could do is, once we have a penalty, we have to change something. And more, it's very likely that by changing the weights of our network, we will be able to change the result for a given input. So a very practical way to understand what's going on with the performances and give penalty to the network is to introduce the concept of cost function. Again, this is very straightforward at the beginning, but then it gets more complicated, so stay with me for the next couple of slides. Let's recap. So we said that we had one input, we got an output, and that we have essentially one option. Option number one is to change the weights. Option number two is to change the biases, or option number three is to change both of them. Fair enough. So what we can do is we can have the desired output here. We can specify the output given by the network. In this case, is a 6, so already here the network is making a mistake. And then we take the weights and the biases and we put them into a cost function. So all those four parameters are included into what we call a cost function. Now, interestingly, if we look back at the network through the cost function, we can tune the parameters and change these weights. By changing these weights, and you can see that are changing by looking at the colors of the activation functions and at the colors of the edges here, hopefully we're going to get into a situation where the network behaves as we want, meaning that the network is providing us output at 0.95 in position 5, which kind of corresponds to what we want, right? Because all these neurons are firing very low values, and this one is firing a 0.95 probability, which is high enough. Great. But now the real question is, how do we change weights and biases so that we get what we want from the network? So what is the right direction? So we already defined what a cost function looks like, but we could actually use the same representation, the same mathematical formulation to think about the network. For instance, here we could think about the network as a function that takes as input parameters, the weights and the biases, a cost function, and our input. Now, this is a very practical way to think about it because, again, if we take input, weights, biases, and cost function, we have a kind of dual representation for the network, the ANN, that can be compared with the mathematical representation of the cost function. And this is precisely what I will do in the next slide. We're now able to see the two functions put one beside the other. On one side, the neural net, on the other side, the cost function. And compare the inputs, for instance. In one case, it's the 784 integer values corresponding to the pixels of the input image. In the second case, the 8,000 numbers, actually floats, corresponding to weights and biases. When it comes to parameters, for the neural net, the weight and biases are kept fixed, frozen, as parameters, while the labels and the outputs, approximately 60,000, are the parameters of the cost function that are entering here. Finally, when it comes to the output of the neural net, as we saw before, it's a vector of 10 numbers that essentially gives us the probability of one specific digit. And then there is, for the cost function, just one value. It is very practical at this point to make some approximations in our notation, just to simplify it a little bit. So I'm going to essentially drop all these three values here from the neural net function and the three values there for the cost function. And I will indicate with CW hat the entire thing, and the neural net function is going to be indicated with this formulation. Now, let's start from the cost function. Let's try to look a little bit closer to this very interesting function. So, the first thing that I would like to share is the fact that we could imagine a cost function as a function that essentially is created using these 8,000 parameters, and we could actually plot the cost function in 1D if instead of 8,000 parameters we had only one dimensional vector. We could plot, for instance, a cost function like this one, quadratic cost function, that it's very simple. It can be, it's differentiable, and we can also get the derivative in a closed form solution. So if we want to plot what the derivative would look like to find the minimum, we would have a tangent vector here that will produce this output. So we would pretty quickly find the minimum of this function by computing this derivative. But what happens if my cost function is not as simple as a quadratic function? Let's say that my cost looks like this. A lot of peaks, a lot of valleys, and we don't know where to go, essentially. So one interesting thing that we could do is to explore this cost function. And to do that, we are going to move this dot. Let's say that we start in this position, but we could really start anywhere else in the horizontal axis of this function. The interesting question, as I was mentioning, is shall we go right or shall we go left? And how can we make this decision? How can we take this decision? Well, an interesting thing to do in this situation is to take into account again the gradient of this function. So what we could do is to look at the gradient, look at the direction of the gradient, and then moving accordingly. Why would we do that? Well, if you think about the gradient as the slope of the tangent line at this point, you can intuitively understand that this tangent line is very helpful because it defines the direction of the slope, right? So the more we move in this direction, the more the slope will be towards the right part of the screen. So if we take this right direction, we move the dot, and we find a local minimum. Is it the best option? Probably not, but it is one possible solution. And it is a solution that we can find in a very small amount of steps, so very small training time. Obviously, it's not the global optimum because it's this one, but we will see in a minute how can we find a trade-off between training time and optimality of the solution. The interesting thing here is that once we have found the minimum, we have a tangent that is parallel to the horizontal axis, and this indicates that we got to the bottom of this valley.
Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. If you like the video, do give us a thumbs up and share it. Also, check out amazing discounts and offers on our premium courses in the description below.